We want our coffee in the lobby. We watch our worship on the screen. We got a rock star preacher who won't wake us from our dreams. We want our blessings in our pocket. We keep our missions overseas. For the hurting in our city, or would we even cross the street? But we want to see the heart set free and the tyrants kneel. The walls fall down and our land be healed. But church, if we want to see change in the world out there, it's got to start right here. It's got to start right now. We want to start right here. We want to start right now. I'm like the brother of the prodigal, turned his nose and puffed his chest. He didn't run off like his brother, but his soul was just as dead. What if the church on Sunday was still the church on Monday too? What if we came down from our towers and walked a mile in someone's shoes? 'Cause we wanna see the heart set free and the tyrants kneel. The walls fall down and our land be healed. But church, if we wanna see the change in the world out there, it's gotta start right here. Surrender all our pride and turn from our ways. He will hear from heaven and forgive our sin. He will heal our land, but it starts right here. We're the people who are called by His name. If we'll surrender all our pride and turn from our ways, He will hear from heaven and forgive our sin. He will heal our land. It's gotta start right. It's gotta start right now. Lord, I'm starting right here. Lord, I'm starting right now. It's gotta start right here. It's gotta start right now. Lord, I'm starting right here. Lord, I'm starting right now.
Hello, Parkview family. Good to see you. Happy Wednesday to you. So glad you could join us here for online Bible study. And we are so thankful that you are joining us. We'd also like it if you would share the broadcast and like the broadcast. That will just be a blessing to us as well. And we would appreciate that so much. So don't forget to share. Don't forget to like the broadcast, especially if you're on Facebook or on YouTube. You can do that as well. Well, we're going to go to the Lord in prayer tonight, and we're going to honor God with our prayer request and blessing the Lord and praying for one another and asking God for His work and power in the hearts and lives of family, friends, and brothers and sisters. And we know that God takes all of our prayers and He holds them and He hears them and He's working through them. And so tonight we want to pray together. Listen, if you're watching online and you have an online prayer request, if you'll just put that in the comment section, that will be a way for you to communicate with our online community that you need prayer. You don't have to get into real specific detail if you want to keep some things private. We certainly understand that. But you can say, hey, pray for me. God knows the need. Or if you might want to say, I need healing or whatever the situation may be, put as much detail in there as you want, as you desire. And somebody will be praying with you online right now as we pray in just a few moments, as well as we'll continue to pray for those requests for the rest of this week. So don't forget to write your prayer request in the comment section. So let's go over some prayer needs that we have on our prayer list. The Bagleys, praying for Mary Britt, Sammy Creighton, Wanda Dennis, Mark Duncan, Mildred Ellis, Elmer and Imogene, Debbie, Shelby, Rita, Max and Louise, Don, Glenn and Jean, Alicia, Nikki, Henry and Terry, Pat King, Jerome, Glenn, R.A., Shelby, Gary McGee, really needs our prayers tonight. He's developed another case of pneumonia, so let's pray about that, asking the Lord to bring healing to his body. Debbie Nair, Carolyn Ray, Sharon Smith, Pat Spivey, Debbie Stone, Howard, Richard, Joe, Wilbur, Ben, Ronnie, Pat, Sally, and Charles. Let's ask the Lord just to move in every heart, every life, every need, and every situation, knowing that God is more than enough to minister to every person's need that is listed on the prayer list tonight. We're also praying for our shut-ins, Wanda, Virginia, Barbara, Marguerite, Marie, Irma, and Norma. These folks need physical touch as well as just encouragement from the Lord. So let's pray for them tonight, asking God just to work in their hearts and in their lives. We're praying for our missionaries, the Tioquans in the Philippines, the Wozniaks in Peru and Colombia, as well as the Olsons in Romania. And we're closing out September in, I guess that's tomorrow maybe, is the last day of September. And we have reached halfway on our $30,000 goal for the Anna Project. So we've raised just over $15,000 for the Olsons. And I'll talk more about that in just a second when we get ready to give. But we want to pray for all of our missionaries tonight, as well as your online prayer requests that you put in the comment section. Well, we're going to go to the Lord in prayer. The Bible says that when we call to Him, He will answer us. He hears us. He works on our behalf. So let's pray together tonight, having the confidence that God hears us when we pray and that He will move in our hearts and in our lives. So let's go to the Lord in prayer and let's believe God together. Father, we come right now in the name of Jesus. We're thankful, God, that we have the privilege of calling upon Your name. That, Lord, we can gather here in the Spirit and agree together on behalf of the needs represented both on the prayer list as well as in the comments. Lord, we know that You're more than enough, that Your resources are not limited, and that, God, Your arm is not short. Lord, we know that You're able to move and to minister on our behalf. And so, God, we bring these needs before You tonight. And we ask, God, that You would move mightily by Your power and by Your Spirit. We pray, God, that you would bring healing, deliverance, Lord, that you would eradicate cancer, that, Lord, you would move mightily by your power, by your grace, by your Holy Spirit. Lord, we're asking you to encourage, to strengthen, to alleviate pain. Lord, we're asking you to heal chronic sicknesses and diseases. We're asking, God, that you would bless your people with divine deliverance. Lord, we're praying that you would heal infections in bodies, Lord, that you would eradicate infection. Lord, we're believing you for your divine touch and power. We pray, oh Lord, that you would move and minister as only you can. We pray for Gary McGee, Lord, that you would touch him even tonight, remove the infection from his body, and Lord, we ask for a miracle on his behalf. We pray for those within our congregation who have come down with COVID. Lord, we pray for a complete deliverance, Lord, of your people, moved by your mighty hand and by your power. Lord, we pray in the mighty name of Jesus that you would touch every person on our list tonight. Lord, we pray for those who have left prayer requests in the comment section. Lord, we pray for them tonight. We ask, God, that you would move upon them supernaturally by your power, by your grace, and by your Holy Spirit. Now, Father, we thank you for moving and ministering. Lord, we pray for our shut-ins tonight. We pray that you would touch them, that you would move upon them, that you would strengthen their bodies, that, Lord, you would encourage their spirits. Lord, that you would move mightily in their hearts and in their lives. Oh, God, we ask a special blessing on our shut-ins, God, believing you for your divine power. Lord, we pray for this whole COVID situation. Lord, we pray that you would help us, God, as a church, to continue to operate safely. Our church family, God, that you would protect them, heal those who are going through those sicknesses. God, we're asking for your divine work. But God, we're asking that you would bring this pandemic to an end, to a conclusion. We pray, oh God, for your mighty touch and your mighty power. We're asking, God, for your work in this area of COVID-19. Bless frontline workers and those who are involved in the virus, God, and serving folks. Lord, we pray for them in the name of Jesus. Lord, we pray for comfort for the grieving, and Lord, that you would move by your power and by your grace. Father, I come tonight praying for our missionaries. I pray blessings upon them. I pray for the Tiaquans in the Philippines. I pray for the Wozniaks in Peru and their ministry, as well as in Colombia. We pray for the Olsons in Romania. God, we're praying for your divine work, your power, your mighty grace for our missionaries. Minister to their needs, touch their lives, make their ministries fruitful. Lord, we thank you and we give you praise. In the mighty name of Jesus, we ask and we thank you, God, for touching our missionaries. Lord, touch our community with the power of Jesus Christ. Touch our community with the gospel. Help us to reach our community. Help us to be part of your solution for this community, God. And Lord, we pray for your work to be done. Minister in the hearts and lives of our community, we pray, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, we're going to give to the Lord tonight. As I said, we just concluded the accounting for September, and we have raised $15,000 for the Anna Project. We still have $15,000 to go. We're blessing our missionary, helping them to raise up these facilities for seniors who may be widows or widowers who are finding themselves in financial difficulty and a place to stay and be able to also to be plugged into ministry up on their capacity. And so we want you to continue to help us in this vital area of giving, and let's honor God and bless the Lord through our giving. So you may want to give to the Anna Project tonight, and you certainly can do that as we give. There are four ways for us to give. You can go to the church website. You can go to the church app. Both of those have the giving tab. You go to those places, and it'll help you navigate how you want to give, whether that be tithe, offerings, mission support, whatever. If you're giving to the Anna Project, there's not a specific designation except for missions, and then under the memo, put Anna. It'll get to the right spot. So you can give through the website and through the church app. You can also text to give, PCOG, to 833-371-5120, or you can scan the QR code for those who are up on modern technology, and that's a way for you to connect and get to the right place as well. And so I've got my offering prepared here that I'm giving, and we're just going to give to God. I just did it just while we were there talking. It's really simple. It's really easy. You can also set up recurring giving. Donna and I do that for our missionary support. We have that just set up to give automatically. And so you can do that. You can do that with your tithe, your offering, building fund, however you want to give to the Lord. Your Wednesday night offering, you can set that up on a recurring system, and it'll just automatically give for you through the PushPay app or website, depending on how you get there. But I want to say thank you so much for giving to God, honoring the Lord with your substance, and blessing God with everything that He is blessed you with. Well, tonight, just before we go into the Word, I just want to remind you that early voting for state elections has already started. Every one of the House of Delegates is up for election. Some on the Senate, Virginia State Senate is up for election. Some of them are in this cycle. But we're also voting for governor, lieutenant governor, as well as attorney general. Listen, it's real easy to sit back and complain about the process and complain about where we are, but also be involved. It's not too late to register to vote if you haven't done so, or you can also vote early by going to your registrar's office, wherever you're at, Newport News, Hampton, York County. You can go right to the registrar's office. During normal business hours, you can vote in person. You can just go and vote in person right now. Or if you're not able to make it and you're not going to be able to make it in November, you can vote absentee. And there's ways that if you're unable to navigate those, we can help you here at the church. And we can't vote for you, and we can't tell you who to vote for necessarily on your ballot, but you certainly can elicit some help to get registered and get the things that you need, and we are able to help you with that. And let me just say this as we, just before the scripture, one of our candidates for governor the other night said, this is a quote, you can go look it up, that parents should not have input into what their kids are taught in school. Basically says not up to the parents. I think that's a bunch of baloney. I think the parent is the number one resource. The parent is the one who's responsible for the children, the child, not the government. So listen, we have a former governor who's running, and that's his belief, and his belief is wrong. We should be the number one resource. Why? Because I said so? No, because the Bible says so. The Bible says that we have an obligation to raise our children the right way, and we ought to make sure that our school systems are doing their part, and it's okay for parents to keep them in check. We have some wonderful people who work in the school system here in Newport News and Hampton and within our church, and God bless you guys. We appreciate you. We love you. We pray for you. There are some people in upper leadership levels who believe that a parent's job is not to have input into their child's life, and I simply don't believe that's a biblical stance. But you can take that as you want to. You can pray about that, and you can do what you feel is best for you and your family. But as for me and my house, I know where that responsibility lies. Well, we're going to talk about the kingdom of God tonight, and we've been looking at a couple of the parables. We looked at the parable of the sower, and tonight we're going to move on into Matthew chapter number 13 again, and we're going to look at two parables together because they are related, and we are going to look at them. But before we talk about the parables, let's talk about, from Matthew chapter 13, what is the kingdom of God? What is the kingdom of God? Or Matthew uses this expression, the kingdom of heaven. And so, in Matthew chapter 13, when he's talking about some of these parables, not the parable of the sower, but some of these other parables, he says something along these lines. The kingdom of heaven is like. And then Jesus will start the parable. Now, when we talk about the kingdom of heaven, we need to understand what we're talking about. And so, I just want to just lay a little bit of groundwork tonight about what is the kingdom of heaven. So the kingdom of heaven, the phrase is used exclusively by Matthew. Both Luke and Mark and John, just in a couple places, they all use the phrase the kingdom of God. They do not use the kingdom of heaven. They are not using that expression at all. Matthew doesn't use really the kingdom of God except for a couple places. Seek ye first the kingdom of God is one of them. There's two other places that Matthew uses the expression exactly, kingdom of heaven, or kingdom of God. He uses the kingdom of heaven phrase 32 times. But I want you to understand that these two phrases, kingdom of God, kingdom of heaven, are fairly synonymous in the Gospels. So when Mark and Luke use primarily the kingdom of God, Matthew uses the kingdom of heaven, and as I said, Matthew uses the kingdom of God a few times, and John uses that expression. He doesn't use the kingdom of heaven at all. He uses the kingdom of God a couple times. Those expressions are pretty much synonymous with one another. So what does that mean? What is it really talking about? Well, in Matthew, the literal way that Matthew writes in the Greek, it's actually would be literally translated the kingdom of the heavens. When he's talking about the kingdom of God, he's talking about the kingdom of the heavens. And so that would be the literal translation. But what does that mean? What does the kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven mean to us? When we think of those expressions, what are we supposed to imagine? Well, I believe one way is from Vincent's Word Studies. This is a great way to think about the kingdom of God or the kingdom of heaven. Once again, we're going to use those synonymously. It says the kingdom of heaven, because of its origin, its end, its king, the character, the destiny of its subjects, its laws, institutions, and privileges are all heavenly. So think about that. Reason why we use this expression is because of where the kingdom of heaven started. Well, it originates in heaven. That's where the throne of God is. Who is the king? Where is this king? He's in the heavens. What is everything that he is doing? What is it, his character? What is the laws, the precepts, the institution? Where do they originate? Where do they find their source? They all find their source in the kingdom of heaven. If we use the other expression, kingdom of God, we can say the exact same thing. Because the kingdom originates with God, it's sustained by God, and God is the king. All of the institution, all of the laws, all the precepts are all about God, His work, and His power. We as subjects are destined to live with God in the kingdom of God or in heaven in the kingdom of heaven. So the kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of God are used to talk about every aspect of the work of God that God is doing, not only in the heavens, but also on earth. It's not just the expression of what it's going to be like during the millennial reign when the kingdom comes to earth. It's not just merely that. It's also the invisible work of the kingdom that has been ongoing since the resurrection of Jesus Christ and His ascension back to the Father. It is both that invisible kingdom that is in operation as well as that visible kingdom that's going to come to pass eventually when we're going to see it here on earth and all throughout all eternity. We're going to be in the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God. And so it's both. It's not either or. It's both and. Both and. It is both the visible and invisible. It's both what is natural now to the natural eye and what is yet to come. That is the kingdom. And so when Jesus is talking about the kingdom, he's talking about the importance of being in the kingdom, the importance of understanding kingdom principles, the importance of living like kingdom citizens. It's all about what God is doing in our lives, both now and in eternity. And so we need to just remember that. So tonight, the two parables that are linked together that we're going to look at is the parable of the hidden treasure and the parable of the pearl of great price. So the hidden treasure is found in Matthew 13:44. The parable of the pearl of great price is same chapter, Matthew 13, but verses 45 and 46. They're back to back. And so Jesus begins to talk about the kingdom of heaven in these terms. Remember, a parable is an earthly story laid beside a heavenly application so that we can gain the application, so that we can understand exactly what Jesus is trying to teach us. So let's talk first about the hidden treasure. Let's read the verse. It's just one verse in this parable. Let's read the verse and just see what Jesus says. This is what he says. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and hid, and for joy over it, he goes and sells all that he has and buys the field. Now, before we go any further and read the other set of scriptures about the pearl of great price, let me just lay a little bit of foundational information. Jesus is not telling us that it is okay to cheat someone out of a piece of land that might be more valuable than the owner realizes. When you read this, you think, well, why wouldn't Jesus instruct the person to tell the landowner how valuable the land is and pay the full price? That's not the point of the parable. We know that Jesus teaches us to operate with integrity. We know that Jesus teaches us to be people of character. We know that the Word of God tells us not to lie, cheat, and steal. Neither would Jesus do any of that. He's giving the analogy so that we can understand the principle. The principle that he wants us to understand is not about how to handle those affairs. It's not about that integrity. Although there's other places where Jesus talks about integrity and character, as well as other parts of the scripture. He's talking about the treasure and the joy, as well as the worth of the treasure. Okay, we're going to dig into that more in just a little bit. Now, let's go to the parable of the pearl of great price. And so, as I said, it's the next two verses, 45 and 46 in Matthew 13. Notice what he says. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant seeking beautiful pearls, who, when he had found one pearl of great price, went and sold all that he had and bought it. So, when we read the parables on face value, we see that these parables are closely related. Although there are some nuances about each parable that makes them unique. Now, Jesus told them back to back without a break because he was connecting them. He was not just willy-nilly going through and giving these parables. He is connecting the parable of the hidden treasure and the parable of the pearl. So he's connecting them together because part of their meanings are connected, although there are some differences. So let's just dig in tonight and talk about a few aspects of these parables, okay? The pearl and the treasure. The treasure is the kingdom of heaven. That's what the treasure is. That's what the pearl of great price is. It's the kingdom of heaven. It's something more valuable than anything else. That's part of the point of the parable. So when the man goes and sells all that he has to buy the field, it's because he believes that the treasure in the field is greater than what he already possesses. As well as the merchant who goes and sells all that he has to buy the pearl, because he believes this one pearl is of greater value than anything else he owns. And so the parable is talking about the kingdom of heaven. But it's not just talking about, you know, eternity. Sometimes when we think about the kingdom of heaven, especially because the word heaven is attached, we think of the kingdom of heaven just being about eternal. It's just an eternal thing, just after we die. That's the kingdom of heaven. Well, that is the kingdom of heaven, but that's not the only application. The total understanding of the kingdom of heaven encompasses every spiritual work and blessing provided through the atonement. So it doesn't just talk about, because heaven is secured to us, our eternal destination is secured to us through the atonement. But it's not just talking about eternity in heaven as our reward. It's also talking about the work of God in our lives. Everything that atonement provides for us. Now, atonement did not just provide the forgiveness of sin. That is, of course, one of the greatest aspects of salvation. Our sins are forgiven. It doesn't get any greater than that. If God didn't bless us with anything else other than the forgiveness of sins, it would still be worth it for Jesus to die on the cross and worth it for us to pursue it with everything we have. But we know, according to the scriptures, that atonement not only provided salvation, it provided peace, it provided healing, it provided deliverance, it provided joy, it provided every work that God would bring into the hearts and lives of His people. He provided that for us through the work of Jesus. Let's just look at a few verses of Scripture together just to solidify this concept. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us, notice this, with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ. Every spiritual blessing has been brought to us through the completed work of Jesus Christ. Every spiritual blessing, no matter what that spiritual blessing is, it's been provided for us. So when we talk about the kingdom of heaven, we're not just talking about eternity, we're talking about every blessing provided for us in the atonement. Listen to what Paul says in the book of Romans. He who did not spare his own son, of course the Father, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Freely give us all things. What does he mean by that? Does that mean he's just going to give us everything? He gives us everything that has been provided for us in the atonement. That does not mean you cannot use this scripture for envy. You cannot use this scripture for covetousness and say, oh, I like what that person's house, so he's going to give me that, because that's not what he's talking about. He's talking about that every blessing provided for us through the atonement, he who spared not his own son, how shall he not so also with him freely give us all things? Everything that Jesus provided. He provided that wholeness. He provided healing. He provided emotional peace. He provided healing of our scars and wounds. He provided deliverance from every evil work of the enemy. We don't have to live under anxiety. We don't have to live with night terrors. We don't have to live under suppression of the devil. We don't have to live under depression. We don't have to live under discouragement. Why? Because Jesus, in His atonement, provided victory for His children, His church, so that we could have all of these spiritual blessings. They are provided for us. And we have to lay hold of those promises. We have to lay hold of those blessings. Our evangelist Sunday night, Brother Travis Gore, he talked about that. That we as the church need to say amen to the promises of God. Yes, God, we believe it. So be it. We trust you for it. We believe you for it. These things have been provided for us through Jesus Christ. One more verse of Scripture. The kingdom of God is not eating and drinking. Okay? The kingdom of God is not about, it's not just about rules and regulation and religiosity and all of those, you know, religious rituals that some of the Jews really got tied up into in the New Testament era, as well as some of modern day Christians can get tied up into. But the kingdom of God is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. So the kingdom of God is the work of God. It is every aspect of that work. Yes, we're saved. Yes, we're healed. Yes, we're delivered. Yes, we're set free. Yes, we've been blessed. Yes, we've been have every good work brought into our lives. And yes, the icing on top is that one day we're going to go live with Jesus forever and ever and ever and ever and ever. Yes, in the kingdom of God or the kingdom of heaven, however you want to describe it. So Jesus is talking about the treasure or the pearl, it's about the kingdom. It's about what the kingdom represents for our lives, because that's what he says. The kingdom of heaven is like. Both parables start that way. So, let's talk about the parable of the hidden treasure. Here's a little nuance that's given to us in Scripture. This treasure was found not by a person who was seeking treasure. This is how this differs from the pearl of great price. It says there was a man in a field and he found a treasure. It doesn't say he was looking for treasure. And most likely, when it talks about treasure, when you really stop to think about, many commentators believe that what this verse is talking about is that there were mineral deposits in a piece of land. It wasn't like, you know, like some pirate come and hid some treasure or something along those lines. But most likely what the parable was representing is, you know, that there was mineral deposits of value that were in the field, which would have caused the field to grow in value compared to just the value of the land itself. And so this person is not looking for treasure, but seemingly stumbles upon treasure. Something that is precious, something that is valuable, something that is to be desired. And he hides it. Why would he hide it? Because he doesn't want anybody else to find it until he can get it. Now, that is just Jesus telling us how valuable the treasure was to the person. That doesn't mean we shouldn't share the treasure of God's kingdom. Once again, he's talking. The main thrust of these parables is to talk about the value of the kingdom of God. Okay? So, the pearl. The merchant was seeking pearls. So the first man, Jesus does not say he was seeking treasure. He says he was in a field, he found treasure, he hid it, he went, sold everything he had, bought the field. The merchant is seeking beautiful pearls. He's seeking out pearls and treasure, and he finds one. He possesses some means to have the ability to recognize what the treasure was. He also obviously had some means to purchase pearls, but when he finds this one pearl, it's worth more than anything else he owns and possesses. And so therefore, he sells what he has to get this one pearl. So the first man is not necessarily seeking anything, but finds something. The second man is seeking something and finds something more valuable than anything he could imagine. So let's just dig a little deeper. So one was not seeking treasure and found it, and I just said that. Another one was seeking treasure and found it. The pearl and the treasure are of such value that nothing else compares to their worth. So what is Jesus trying to say to us? Some people stumble upon the kingdom of God. They're not necessarily looking for it, but they find it. And they realize once they find it that the life that they are living now does not compare to the value of being in possession of this treasure. The other parable, he already has some treasure. He already has some understanding. This would be like a person who's already in the kingdom of God, seeking more of God, and comes to find out more understanding of the mysteries of God and the mysteries of the kingdom and the value of the kingdom that they are willing to sell out. Both of these parables are about selling out, giving everything, giving your all. It's about understanding how valuable the kingdom of heaven is. Both men, the man and the merchant, are willing to sell everything to obtain a priceless gift. So, when we talk about how great the kingdom of God is, we have to realize that being in the kingdom is the best thing that's ever happened to us. The scripture teaches us that. That's why Matthew's gospel, when Jesus is teaching about, it's not about what you eat and what you wear and where you're going to stay, seek you first the kingdom of God. He's telling us that because the kingdom of God is of such great value. You and I, sometimes as Christians, we get so used to being around this great thing we call being saved that it becomes like just second nature. Sometimes we lose the awe. Sometimes we lose the glory of it. We lose how valuable it is to be in a relationship with God. Let's be honest, as humans, we often can just slip into routine. We can slip right into religious service without having a heart that's going after God. And so when Jesus is talking about this parable, he's talking about a couple different aspects. We can break it down. There's multiple ways we can break it down. One, we could break it down as the first parable is about finding salvation initially, that how the man is not in the kingdom, doesn't own anything, doesn't possess anything, yet he finds this treasure and he goes and he's willing to do whatever it takes to get the treasure. We can also use the same analogy to talk about how the second parable could be someone who's already in the kingdom, who already has some levels of treasure in a relationship with God, but they come to realize that there's more available to them than what they first believed. Here's the point that we need to understand, is that the kingdom of God, the work of God in our lives, is more valuable than anything else that we possess. Therefore, it should be worth everything to us. That's what Jesus is teaching. Now, we live in a time and in a culture that teaches people that mediocrity is commitment. But that's not what Jesus is talking about. Jesus is talking about, are you willing to give everything away to hold the most important thing of all of life, the kingdom of heaven? Are you willing to sell what you have? Remember the guy that comes to Jesus, and he's a young ruler, and he comes to Jesus and he says, Jesus, what must I do to inherit the kingdom of God? And Jesus said, well, keep the commandments, and he lists them, and the guy says, I've done that since my youth. I've kept the commandments. I know what the commandments are. I've followed them. I've done what I was supposed to do. And Jesus said, you lack one thing. Go and sell everything that you have. What if Jesus asked us to sell everything we have? You see, the possessions of this world, we're supposed to hold loosely, because nothing compares to the glory of being in the kingdom of God. Nothing compares to salvation. Our money, our 401k, our savings account, our possessions. None of that should compare to being in the kingdom of God. Jesus said, this treasure is worth everything. Notice what Paul says. Paul comes to an understanding through his Damascus Road experience that his relationship with God becomes the most important thing in his life. Let me just recap his encounter from Acts chapter 9, the first place that that's recorded for us. He recounts it two other places in the book of Acts. Paul is on his road, is on his way to Damascus on the road, and he is going to Damascus with a letter from religious leaders to arrest Christians, to bring them into persecution because they believed that Christianity was a threat to Judaism and to their way of religious life. Just a sidebar, I wonder if anybody feels that way about Christianity today, that we are a threat to their way of life and to their belief system. Paul believed that so strongly, or Saul believed that so strongly, that he was willing to go hunt down Christians, to bring them for trial, bring them for accusation, arrest, possible even death. He was consenting to the death of Stephen. He held the clothes. He was there. He gave his nod of approval. He says later on in the book of Acts that he consented to persecution and death, imprisonment and death, and beatings of those who were of the way, he says. But on the road to Damascus, he had an encounter with Jesus that, if you've ever read the story, you realize it transformed his life. He saw the glory of God, so much so that he went blind, and Jesus talked to him. And Saul, realizing it was the Lord, said, "Who are you, Lord?" He knew he was having some kind of divine encounter. And Jesus said, "I'm Jesus of Nazareth, whom you are persecuting." See, when you persecute Christians, you're not just persecuting a Christian, you're persecuting the Lord. Side note, when you talk about other Christians and put them down, you're not just talking about the Christians, you're talking about the Lord. So if the persecution of the church also is persecution of Jesus, then gossiping against other Christians is also gossiping against the Lord. We should be careful what we do. But he had this experience. "I'm Jesus, whom you're persecuting. It's hard for you to kick against my plan. It's hard for you to kick against the goads." He's given the analogy of an animal who the master of the animal is goading them along. And the animal would kick against it. He says, you can't kick against my plan. You can't stop my plan. And then he says, "Lord, what would you have me to do?" Jesus says, "Go into the city and wait. You're going to receive some instruction." Of course, Ananias is being prepped by the Lord at the same time, or right around the same time, to go in and be the instrument through which God's going to use to lay his hands on Saul so that he might receive his sight, as well as be baptized in the Holy Spirit, because Saul got saved that day on the road to Damascus. And from that moment on, his life took a dramatic 180 degree turn. He was heading in one direction and now he's heading in another. But notice how he describes it in the book of Philippians. It is much like the pearl and the treasure. He's willing to give up everything to possess the kingdom of God. Everything. Notice what he says. "Yet indeed also I also counted all things lost for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I've suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish that I may gain Christ." He says, "I've lost everything, but that's okay. I'd give it all away. I've given it all away. I've counted it as nothing. I've counted it as rubbish." If you read from the King James, counts it as dung, waste, human waste. "I count it all as waste, nothing, something to be thrown out, animal waste," whatever analogy you want to use. "It's manure. Everything that I ever thought was important, now I say it's worth absolutely nothing, that I may have the excellency of Christ." What's he talking about? Having that relationship with God, being in the kingdom, being in the fellowship with Jesus Christ, being in fellowship in the kingdom of God and what God is doing here on earth, as well as what God was going to do throughout all of history and all of eternity. He says, "I counted everything else as loss." What did he lose? What did he give away? He was prestigious in his religious pursuit. He was a Pharisee of the Pharisee. He was of the tribe of Benjamin. He persecuted Christians. He was of the strictest sect of the Pharisees. He was pursuing it with all that he had. And yet, after all of his time of education, all of his time of study, all of his times of religious pursuit, and all the times he thought he was doing the right thing, he realized that it was all worth nothing, and he laid it all aside for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ. That's what the parable's talking about. Selling everything we have. Selling out. Are you willing to sell out to follow God? Are you willing to give your all? Are you willing to give everything to Jesus? Are you willing to say, God, I'll go anywhere, I'll do anything, I'll give away my stuff if I need to, I will do whatever it takes. And you might be sitting on the other side of this camera saying, yes, Pastor, that's what I'll do. But yet sometimes we come in Sunday and we can't even lift our hands to the Lord, or we can't even sing a song, or we can't even put forth any effort to magnify the Lord and bless the Lord, and yet we say we're committed to selling out. The parable tells us they sold out everything they had that they may have the hidden treasure in the field or the pearl of great price, because that was more valuable than anything. Let's read on. He says, I want to be found in Him, not having my own righteousness. See, that's the righteousness that Paul used to have. Self-righteousness, religious righteousness, not having my own righteousness, which is from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which is from God by faith. He said, I want to have my own righteousness. I want to have the righteousness of God. And then notice this, that I may know Him. Paul already knew Him. This is what he realized. The revelation of knowing Him did not stop at the moment of His salvation. It did not stop at the moment of His Spirit baptism. It did not stop when He started into ministry. It did not stop when He achieved certain levels of success in ministry and winning people to the Lord and making disciples and planting churches. It didn't stop there. He said, I want to know Him. That means that He still wants to know Him. He wants to know Him more. He wanted to know Him in more increasing ways. There's more to God than we've ever experienced. So how could we ever get to the place we said that we know it all, we've seen it all? It's an impossibility. We're talking about a God who is infinite and unsearchable, a God whose wisdom is beyond our comprehension, whose peace passes all our understanding, a God who is much greater and much higher than we are. Our thoughts on our best day do not even approach the worst thoughts of God on His worst day, even though God doesn't have bad days. But our best thought on our best day is so far beneath this God we serve. Paul said, I want to continue. Know Him. I want to be in fellowship with Him in the power of His resurrection, meaning He's willing to die. He wants to have the power of the resurrection in His life. We see when Paul gets to Timothy, 2 Timothy, he said, I've run my race. I've finished the course. I'm willing to lay down my life. If this is my time, it does not matter. My life is not with my own. I've been purchased, was what Paul said in the book of Corinthians. I no longer am my own. I am the Lord's. Whatever He desires, whatever He wants, that's what I want. My life belongs to God. That's what Paul's saying. That's what the Scripture teaches where we got to get to. Notice what he says. He says, not only do I want to know the power of His resurrection, but the fellowship of His sufferings, being conformed to His death, if by any means I may obtain to the resurrection from the dead. I like the way he says it later on. I don't have that verse. I just want to read it to you. It's such an amazing verse that he says later on. I think it's verse number 13 of this same chapter, and he talks about being laid hold of, and he wants to now pursue God in this same way that God touched his life. Here's what it says in verse number 12. Not that I've already attained or am already perfected, but I press on, notice what he says here, that I may lay hold of that for which Christ Jesus also laid hold of me. He said, something got a hold of my heart, and ever since then, I've been trying to get a hold of it again. Not that he wasn't saved, not that he wasn't blessed, not that he wasn't used by God. He says, I'm laying hold of what laid hold of me. In other words, I'm hanging on. I'm not letting go. I'm giving it all. He was willing to be shipwrecked, beaten. He was willing to be stoned. He's willing to be persecuted. He was willing to go to jail for the work of the ministry because he sold out to God. God tells us that the kingdom is that valuable. It's that valuable to give our lives, to give up all of our stuff. Let's talk about our stuff just for a second. In both these parables, they sold everything they had. Our stuff, when we die, it may pass down to our children, our grandchildren. But you know what's going to happen eventually to that stuff? It's all just going to fade away. It's just stuff. Yeah, it's good to have those blessings while we're here on earth. It's good to have means and opportunity to be used by God to help others, to bless others, and those kind of things. But in reality, we need to keep that in perspective. It's just stuff. And one day it's all going to burn up, it's all going to be gone, and all that's really going to matter is what we've done for the Lord, how we've served Him. We should leave a legacy. I know we should leave an inheritance for our children, our children's children, the Bible says so. But the greatest inheritance we could leave is a legacy of faith, a legacy of serving God, of selling out and being everything. It'd be great if we could leave them some money or a house or whatever. But the greatest legacy, above all of that, is the legacy of serving God, the legacy of faith. Jesus said the kingdom of God was so valuable that the man who stumbled on the treasure in the field hid the treasure in the field again, went and sold everything he had, and for joy, wasn't a drudgery, didn't even feel like a sacrifice, but for the joy, sold all he had to buy the field. The merchant was the same way. Sold everything he had to get one pearl that was of great price. This work and life in the kingdom of God is of that value. Let's go for it. Let's go after it. Let's sell out. Let's give more of ourselves to God. Let's stop holding back. Let's stop letting life get in the way. There's always going to be a reason why you can't come to church, or why you can't worship God, or why you can't do this, or you can't do that. There's always going to be those reasons. Sometimes we just have to pull up our bootstraps, fight our way through life, and serve God in spite of all the stuff. Pray, seek God, worship God, come to church, be involved, and not let Satan keep throwing things in our way to hinder us. Because that's how valuable being in the kingdom of God is. That's where we want to be. We want to be there in the kingdom of God in that way. Let's pray together tonight. Father, we're so thankful for your word. We're so thankful, God, for the challenge of Scripture that, Lord, really, really challenges us to be willing to lay it all aside in pursuit of you. To count everything as loss that we may have you. The man who found the treasure in this parable sold everything he had, so did the merchant. Lord, help us to be willing to lay everything aside that we may follow you. Because, Lord, the treasure that you have in your kingdom, that pearl of great price representing your kingdom, it's worth it. It's worth it. God, once again, renew in us in this day, in this generation, in this cultural time, when commitment and sacrifice seem to be so little at times. Help us sell out for you. Help us be committed to the kingdom, your kingdom, your work, your life that you provided for us. So, Father, we need your help. And Lord, we know that when we submit ourselves to you, that you're going to do it. So, Lord, we thank you for it. Thank you for your word that challenges us, that calls us to strive even more for the excellency of knowing you. Touch us all, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, just before we go tonight, I want to remind you of a couple things. Tomorrow night, we're having drive-through prayer, and we would love for you to be part of that drive-through prayer ministry. It is a phenomenal time, and it's a great opportunity to be on the cutting edge, being right out there with real life, with people, not all of whom go to church, but they drive through the prayer line because they want prayer. And you say, well, Pastor, how can God work in their lives if they're not really Christians? Well, God can plant seeds and God can work and minister. And who knows? These could be the times when God works in their lives and he uses this to draw them to himself. And so it is a great ministry opportunity. You may say, well, Pastor, I don't really pray good in public and do those kind of... Well, listen, first of all, let me help you. Just say it like this. I may not pray good in public yet, but ask the Lord to help you. We can all get there. We don't have to pray like, you know, some elegant prayer that we read in the book somewhere. Those are great and wonderful. And I've heard people pray, and I'm like, and I'm just, my jaw just drops. I'm like, wow. But listen, I'm going to tell you something. God just hears us when we talk to him. Just talk to him like talking to your neighbor. He hears that, and he honors that, and he blesses that. It's not about the eloquence of the prayer. It's about the faith. And when you are able to bump fists with somebody through their window or even shake somebody's hand through their window and agree with them in prayer, there's some powerful things that's taken place. We've seen through the two times of ministry, we've seen answers to prayer. I can remember that first time, a lady called the church office the very next day and said, Pastor, because I happened to be the one to pray with her, and she said, Pastor, when I came through the prayer line, I needed prayer. I was praying about a situation. I remembered her, and she said, and it was about something that was going on that night. She stopped by for prayer before she went on to that situation, and she said, God moved a miraculous way. It was the best thing, best meeting I've ever had. And she said, I attribute that to the prayers of your church. Those are some of the great things. Those are some really cool things. There'll be people who pull through that line with addictions and those kind of things, and we'll get to pray with them and ask Jesus to touch their lives. We want you to be a part of that. It's not too late to sign up and come. Be here at the church at 4 o'clock for just a brief organizational time. It starts at 4:30, and we're going to start praying and believing God. So you can be part of that. If by chance you say, Pastor, I can't make it tomorrow night, would you spend some time praying for this ministry event, asking the Lord to use those who can come? So maybe you're not able to be here on the property, but you could also spend some time in prayer and be part of that by praying there at home. Also, this coming Saturday and Sunday, Saturday is community serve day. We're going to be blessing our community, serving our community, loving our community, inviting people to church, working in our community. So we just want to love our community. And so we want you to help us be here at the church at 8:30 if you would like breakfast. We're going to start working promptly at 9 o'clock. So we'll have some donuts for you. We will also provide lunch for you as well, around 12:30, somewhere in that neighborhood. And so if you would like breakfast, be here at 8:30. We'll have some coffee and donuts, those kind of things, get us started. And then we will be on our way to just ministering to our community, loving our community, serving our community. So be here at 8:30 for breakfast, 9 o'clock if you want to skip the breakfast part and just come here to be part of the ministry. And then Sunday, still there's time for you to invite your friends, families, neighbor, co-workers who do not go to church for community day. It's going to be a free picnic and just, day of fun after service. Be a part of that. We want you to be a part. Just come to church, dress casual. Just plan to stay for the picnic. And let's just have a great day. Let's just, when we're here, and, we have folks that maybe who do not come to church will be a part of this. Let's just mingle with them, get to know them, and just try to strike up some conversations and relationship with them, because that's really the purpose of this. It's not just for a church fellowship. It's actually to make connections in our community. So that's going to happen Sunday right after church. So come casual, just come ready to stay for lunch and ready to have a good time and make some community connections, and let's just see what the Lord will do. Let's pray together also that the Lord will give us at least one more soul. We had somebody saved last Sunday. What a wonderful experience of salvation for Milton. And we thank God for that. We'd love to see some more people saved this Sunday. I want you to pray with me, and let's believe God for His work to be done. Well, I want you to know that Donna and I pray for you. We love you, and we're really excited to be your pastor. And we definitely continually lift you up to the Lord in prayer. And we can't wait to see you Sunday, hopefully in person here at the Family Life Center. We've got some brand new chairs here, so everybody should have a much comfortable seat, especially some of you who had to sit in those metal folding chairs with just about this much padding, or the Mormon chairs who were not anointed for sitting at all because they hurt your back. We've got those out of the way, and we've got some nice chairs here for everybody, and plenty of space, plenty of room. We've got a place for you. So we'd love to see you here in the Family Life Center at 10:30. If you can't make it by chance, you can always join us on our Facebook page and our YouTube channel. We'll see you Sunday at 10:30 for Community Day. It's going to be great. You don't want to miss it. Have a great night. God bless.